Hello, very good morning. It's great to have you here on Thursday edition of Ireland AM.
We are delighted to have you with us. And you know what? We've got loads on the way.
We certainly do. It has been, did you know, 10 years since this took over the internet. You can do the Harlem Shake. I absolutely love this. Yes, of course, that is the Harlem Shake. For those who don't know, to celebrate the anniversary of the viral meme, Paul Ryder is going to be here to run through some of the biggest online trends of the past few years. And we may have roped in a few familiar faces to show us their moves. So you'll want to stay tuned for that at 7:45.
Tommy realised it was the 10-year anniversary about a month ago, and he's been texting our group every day. Are we doing the Harlem? Like, are we going to talk about it? Are we going to talk? He's so excited about this. Brian Lloyd is going to be here to give us his verdict on everything from the Oscar-nominated movie The Whale to Pamela Anderson's new Netflix documentary.
And we're going to be meeting the inspirational story of a Waterford man who has survived cancer three times.
Incredible. Now, Alan, what is on the... Look at that.
Oh, yes, we're in the kitchen already with Alberto Rossi. He's making us a sweet Italian dish. What are you making for us?
They are called chiacchiere, Alan.
What is it?
Chiacchiere. Oh, it's a specific... It's a very difficult word today, you know? Chiacchiere. Chit-chat in English, you know?
What?
Chit-chat. You know, chit-chat. It's talking, you know?
Chit-chat.
Chit-chat. Chiacchiere. So it's a specific sweet that you serve during the carnival season in Italy.
Are you going to burn it?
I'm going to fry them.
Will you say burn for me?
Burn.
Oh, burn. Now, Game of Thrones fans, you're going to love this. Deric is channeling his inner White Walker this morning. Where are you, Deric?
Yes, Al, good morning. We're live here up in Banbridge in County Down this Thursday morning. It's a fine settle start, that mixture of bright spells and cloudy conditions to take us right across the day. But for any Game of Thrones fans out there today, you're in for a very special treat because we are off on a studio tour. So think the Starks, think Jon Snow, think the White Walkers. I'm dressed for the occasion, lads. Really looking forward to this one now.
I am so jealous. I would love to go to that. Yeah, yeah. It's meant to be amazing, Deric. Yeah, enjoy it.
Yeah.
Look how happy
he is.
So
happy. I went to the one in Belfast. Daenerys is like this big. It's terrifying.
Oh, well, that's just Deric. Okay, time to get the news in the Virgin Media News Hub. Here's Anne O'Donnell.
Thanks, Tommy. Good morning. Well, the European Central Bank looks set to announce another rate increase this afternoon. It's expected that the ECB will announce a further 0.5% hike, which may not be the last increase of the year. Here's the details.
Many homeowners face higher mortgage repayments in the coming weeks. The European Central Bank has indicated it will increase interest rates by 0.5% today to 2.5%. The same increase is expected to be announced again next month. The latest hike comes as inflation in the zone remains high, driven in part by the high cost of food. Though inflation did fall last month for the third consecutive month as the cost of the wholesale price of energy fell, down to 8.5% from 9.2% in December. As well as next month's expected hike, a further hike in May, which may be smaller, hasn't been ruled out by the ECB either, if inflationary pressure doesn't ease. Marie Mulcahy, Virgin Media News.
The President of the European Parliament, Roberta Metsola, is in Dublin today for a series of engagements. She's due to meet the Taoiseach, Leo Varadkar, this morning. Later on then, in the afternoon, she'll be addressing both houses of the Oireachtas. To the US now, where the funeral of Tyree Nichols has taken place in Tennessee. The 29-year-old died after being brutally beaten by police in Memphis. Nichols's death, which was captured on video, has prompted nationwide protests and renewed calls for police reform. Some of the nation's most prominent politicians and activists joined family members in calling for change.
This is a family that lost their son and their brother through an act of violence at the hands and the feet of people who had been charged with keeping them safe.
I see the world showing him love and fighting for his justice. But all I want is my baby brother back.
Staying in the US now, where the White House Counsel's office has said the FBI searched President Joe Biden's holiday home in Delaware without finding any classified documents. But agents did take some handwritten notes and other materials relating to Biden's time as vice president for review. Wednesday's search, this is the third for a Biden home or office, was an extraordinary development for a sitting president and made clear that an investigation was continuing rather than fading away.
I think you guys have all received a statement from the president's personal attorney, which laid out that today, in a planned consensual search with the Justice Department, they went through the Rehoboth Beach House, and no classified marked documents were found. This is consistent, I think, with the president from the very beginning of having total cooperation with the Justice Department as it goes through this ongoing investigation.
And finally for now, bidding opens today for an iconic jersey worn by the late basketballer Kobe Bryant, which is widely expected to make a huge amount at auction. Sotheby's auction house is listing the jersey for as much as $7 million. Bryant and his 13-year-old daughter were among nine people killed in a helicopter crash in LA in 2020. The auction bidding ends on the 9th of February.
For car insurance, van insurance, or home insurance, call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
Thank you, Jared. A very good morning to you at home, or if you're indeed streaming online on The Player. We're coming to you live up in Banbridge in County Down this morning, and we are off, guess what, on a Game of Thrones studio tour. So any fans of the fantasy series, you're in for a real treat later on this morning, so do hang with us for that. Anyway, let's take an opening look at weather together now with Conan Doyle with us on cameras. And I have to say, it is a mainly dry and settled start out there this morning. Damp roads out there this Thursday, and we're seeing showers through parts of Monaghan, just on the Dublin-Wicklow border as well, in those moderate to fresh west to southwesterly winds. Now, right across this afternoon, in fact, it's going to brighten up pretty nicely. That mixture of sunshine and cloud cover to take us right across the day. Keep an eye across the northwest, though. We will see drizzle develop a little bit on the persistent side as we edge our way towards the back end of the day. And temperatures very similar to yesterday as well. Top values of 10 to 11 degrees. So tonight, that light rain, light drizzle trailing around Connacht and into parts of Ulster as well. Elsewhere, we're going to see cloudy conditions holding mainly dry and settled as those winds moderate, easing back as we work our way into your Friday morning with values back to about 7 to 9 degrees. So that's how we're shaping up here in a damp but settled start in Banbridge in County Down. We'll be back again live at 7:35.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The Quote Devil's always got one hell of a
quote. After the break, the Mother and Baby Home Redress Scheme has been criticised at an emerged 24,000 people will be excluded.
Yeah, we're going to be discussing that with a survivor of BESPRA after this short break.
Back now. Yesterday, the government faced criticism in the Dáil for its decision not to include all survivors in a proposed mother and baby home redress scheme.
So joining us to discuss this are BESPRA survivor Noel Brown, an assistant professor of human rights at the University of Galway and co-director of the CLAN project, Dr. Maeve O'Rourke. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's great to have you both with us. Maeve, first of all, can we just get an update on what happened in the Dáil yesterday?
Yesterday was Dáil report stage, that is the final Dáil stage before a bill goes to the Seanad of the Mother and Baby Institutions Redress Bill. So that is the government's plan to provide very minimal payments to people who were in mother and baby institutions or county homes. There was a huge debate over whether the government would finally concede that they have to include all survivors, because at present the government's redress plan excludes anybody who was in an institution for less than 6 months before they were separated from their mother. Minister Roderick O'Gorman was on his own on the government benches for the entire time of the debate, defending the indefensible with absolutely no logical explanation for this. Others are excluded too. People who suffered abuse in boarding out placements or abusive adoptive homes that were not properly regulated or overseen, unfortunately, are excluded. Mm. Also, some of the most horrendous abuses are excluded entirely, like vaccine trials, racial discrimination, disability discrimination, or the expatriation illegally of people abroad for adoption.
Wow. It misses out so much. They had an opportunity right now to sit and acknowledge, and there's thousands of people who are going to go unacknowledged. Noelle, you were adopted out from Bessborough when you were 8 weeks old. So you don't come under this scheme.
No, I don't. And I was also the subject of vaccine trials.
You were subject of vaccine trials?
Yes, in Bessborough, like many, many children.
You were gone at 8 weeks old?
Yes, 8 weeks old.
And they used that time to experiment on your body?
Yeah. Yeah, and the reason, apparently, because I've read the reports on it, is because what they were doing, they wouldn't be allowed to do it in any other environment.
What? How are you feeling today?
I'm angry, but also hopeful that this is not the end, because the country is with us, and I think they've underestimated the scale of the horror that people are invested in now, because there isn't a family in Ireland who isn't affected by this issue or doesn't know someone who's affected by this issue. And the level of the people that are behind us in terms of the emailing campaign over the last while on repeal the seal, when they wanted to seal the records from the Commission of Investigation. The country is with us because they understand, and they are tired of seeing these women and their babies re-traumatised. This has been going on for many, many years, and we need to acknowledge the scale of the horror. And this is an opportunity to do this, finally, and not keep burying it.
Yeah, well, it was such an opportunity. And the minister has kind of said that you can't remember the first 6 months. Isn't that what he said? He's kind of gone back on that a little bit. But you were 8 weeks. I mean, what impact has this had on you and your life?
I know plenty of survivors who, of course, they don't have a conscious memory, but it's in our bodies. That's what happens when you're in those environments. And particularly if you're the subject of vaccine trials. I was lucky. I was in a loving family. I grew up in a loving family. But that forced separation doesn't go away.
No.
Being the subject of vaccine trials. And the hardest thing I've had to deal with as an adoptee is how I am treated because I'm adopted by the state and by the Catholic Church. I'm 20 years trying to extract my information. I'm still denied my medical history, which, as we know, still denied it.
I thought that was opened up.
No. And please, there's so much spin around this from the government and from Minister O'Gorman saying that everybody has access to their information. They don't. What they're doing with their family medical histories is to say, we will redact it and send it to a GP. You can't have it. People are dying without that information. The first thing a GP says to you when you go to him with any issue is, do you have a family history of?
Yeah.
And our response has to be no.
Oh, wow.
So there are probably chronic conditions out there. We know there are chronic conditions as a direct result of not having your family history, which is a basic human right, as is our identities, the right to our identities. The European Commission has said that so many times to this government.
I think if anyone talks to a foster parent of a child who is taken before from a troubled home before 6 months, and if you listen to them, there are issues. There can absolutely be psychological issues with children,
yeah,
because those times are so important. With this, excluding these people from this money, if we talk about it, it's up to 800 million. Mm-hmm. To fix the problem with what happened with the nursing home issues could be up to 15 billion. So just to put it in context,
yeah,
of what's going on here. With these mothers and these babies who have been traumatised by this country again and again and have so many health issues.
Yeah.
So, like, Noelle, why in God's name are they fighting such an arbitrary number? Like, where did they come up with the 6 months? Like, what's the point of that? Sorry, Maeve, where did they come up with the 6 months? Have we?
No, there is.
Like, did they just go?
The department has refused to release through Freedom of Information any of its deliberations and where the arbitrary dividing line came from. They say they don't want to traumatise the people that they're excluding and that this information would be used essentially for campaigning. It's really important to say, like, the overall figure they have estimated they'll pay out at present with the current scheme they're proposing is 800 million, but the actual individual payments are menial. A mother who was institutionalised for up to 3 months will receive 5,000 euro. A woman who was forced into unpaid labour from 3 to 6 months receives 1,500 euro. And people have to sign away all of their legal rights against the state for this. Mm-hmm. These are tiny amounts. The 800 million includes all of the IT, the administration, the advertising costs, and they're assuming in that 800 that all of the people they are including will manage to find out about it and apply within the 5-year cutoff date, which isn't realistic.
Wow. Can I? You're talking about the work payment, because women in these homes, they worked.
They sure did.
And the Catholic Church made money off the back
of
that labour.
A lot of money.
Noelle, how are you feeling? There's a vacuum in the Catholic, there's silence. There's just silence. There's nothing. We've got the government saying a lot.
Yeah.
But well, this using is the Catholic Church.
Absolutely. But using the argument of, well, you know, we have to keep the costs down. It's a lot of money. The Catholic Church should be paying for this. They're one of the wealthiest organisations in the world. And they made so much money off the backs of those women, like my birth mother and me, because they sold babies, sold them all over the world.
Yep.
They made so much money. So they should be paying for this. If the state is struggling to pay it, the congregation should be paying it. And around the six-month rule, I think they made that decision based on the fact that they know a lot of the time that six, you know, 8 weeks as a time to take a baby wasn't adhered to. They took babies within hours. Yeah. Within weeks.
As in illegally.
Illegally.
That to be taken so early was actually illegal. So if people start coming with, you know, those claims, it'll be apparent that there was so much illegal practice, which we know about.
We know about
it.
Yeah. Well, they could, we can talk about that now.
Yeah.
It's obviously got voted down in the Dáil yesterday. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Where does it go from here?
To the Seanad. The minister is going to have to come in many times to the Seanad now and explain himself. And he has the opportunity to go back to his officials to say, this isn't good enough. We, as a government, to go to his cabinet colleagues and say, we need to fix this. It's an easy fix. It's not going to delay things. Mm. If they simply include everybody, if they give a medical card to everybody because at present, that's also an exclusion. Only if a mother was there for more than 6 months can she have an enhanced medical card. So there is an answer to this. Minister Gorman can come to the Seanad and say, we heard you. We heard the people of Ireland and we're sorry, but I've spoken with my officials and it's fixed.
So how do people go about, how do you try and convince the minister?
Write a letter.
This is the right way to go. Is it write a letter? Is there like...
Emails. We broke the Dáil server on the Repeal the Seal campaign and the volume of emails from TDs that have contacted me is huge at the moment. We need to keep the pressure on and the country is with us and I think they've not realised that, the government. So we've got to keep the pressure.
So right now, you can, because I know on the Clan project, you're looking for answers.
Clan.org, CLANNproject.org, and we have a tab with redress and that gives you the content for your email, a way of sending it from your own email account.
Yeah.
People can ring their TDs and senators. That is actually a really important way of being heard. Every phone call makes a massive difference.
Yeah. Right now, if this is something that you are connecting with at home, I don't know if you're looking at your baby and thinking about this, you can do that. Mm-hmm. Like, that is something Absolutely. That you can do. Yeah. Listen, Noelle, I'm sure that you've been talking to survivors ever since yesterday. And are you all right?
Yeah, I'm OK. I mean, I was very angry and upset last night and particularly affected by Richard Boyd Barrett talking in the Dáil as well as about his own personal experience. It takes a lot of bravery. It takes a lot to talk about your experience. Yeah. And I've been talking about it for a long time. But I think I have to, because there are people that can't. But I'm angry and I'm upset, but the fight isn't over.
You
We're not going to stop.
So eloquently about it, and I think it's reached, you can see why it's reached everybody in Ireland as well over this. Noelle Brown, thank you so much. And of course, human rights lawyer, Dr. Maeve O'Rourke, thank you. For joining
Thanks,
us this morning.
Cheers. We're taking a quick break now, but after the break, Sean Defoe will be here to run through the stories behind the headlines.
See you shortly.
Time now to take a look at this morning's papers. We're going to start with the Irish Times. Its headline, ambulance response times risk patients' lives. Overlapping ambulance services in Dublin provided by the National Ambulance Service and Dublin Fire Brigade are leaving the public at risk, according to a major report, the release of which was strongly opposed by Dublin City Council.
Row erupts as ESB drags heels over €50 refunds to households. Households overcharged on their electricity bill will not be repaid anytime soon as the ESB looks to avoid using its own money for refunds. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. Crazy.
The Examiner leaves with 12 patient safety events in EDs. The HSE is investigating 12 major patient safety incidents in accident and emergency departments over the course of the winter.
Nursing home compensation is inevitable. Paying compensation over illegal care home charges and the denial of disability payments is inevitable, according to coalition politicians. That's the top story on the Daily Mail.
The Mirror goes with, we're at breaking point. Publicans warned they can't afford to take any more financial hits after price increases for Guinness came into effect yesterday.
The Sun leads with footy charter leaked. Dodgy owners will be blocked from getting hold of UK footy teams under a huge clean-up.
The Star leads with jailed ex-Garda quizzed over Monk Link. Former Garda John Murphy has been quizzed over suspected links to Jerry the Monk Hutch.
And the Herald goes with, man stabbed his former boss for killing Michaela. A man who stabbed his former employer 19 times during a psychotic episode in which he believed his boss was responsible for the murder of Michaela McAreevy has been found not guilty of attempted murder by reason of insanity. Well, pretty stark headlines again this morning. We are joined this morning by Bauer Media's political correspondent, Sean DeVoe. Good morning to you, Sean.
Morning, guys. How are you?
Let's talk with a different story that's on the front of the Examiner as well this morning about the Taoiseach. So Micheál Martin has signalled the support of decriminalisation of drugs. This is something we've seen in a couple of other countries, but Ireland may be going that direction too.
Yeah, so this is the story from Danny McConnell on the front page of The Examiner, and sort of comes out of the comments of a couple of Fianna Fáil TDs yesterday, one of them being James Lawless, who's the chair of the Oireachtas Justice Committee, and he basically said, look, this old row that we've been having over drugs for years, is it a justice issue or is it a health issue? And you've got the two sides of it where obviously justice comes into it in that drugs are illegal, should they stay illegal or not, but then the health side in that there's a lot of people in this country who are very badly addicted and who do need help out, and if you are just constantly, you know, penalising, is that the best way forward? And as you say, some countries have moved in different directions. You look at the likes of Amsterdam, where soft drugs are available in the likes of their cafes, but hard drugs are still illegal. And if you are caught in possession, I think, of soft drugs, that's not illegal as long as it's below a certain amount, but hard drugs still are. And now Micheál Martin basically said, now a bit more tentative, I think the headline probably, you know, makes it sound as though he came out strongly in favour. He's just said, I'm in favour of a health response. Yep. So very politician's answer, isn't it? Let's kick it out to some other people. But yeah, you could see some movement.
It's not, is it Portugal?
Portugal
opened up.
Decriminalised, and they have all these centres, and drug use has gone down.
Yeah, they've treated the likes of heroin as an issue that can be treated. I mean, because if you think of the money that the states spend in trying to stop the spread of drugs, but yeah, it's interesting to see how you have both sides of it.
I think it's interesting walking through Dublin. I don't know what it's like in the rest of the country. You can let us know 0896 111 111, because like you'd walk through and you'd be stoned because just the smell of hash is absolutely everywhere. And I saw two poor things yesterday, and they were smoking heroin, you know. So, this is on the streets in Dublin.
We hear that.
And, this is an issue.
Not just owners, well, you know.
Not just, that's what I'm saying.
You hear in other cities, in Waterford.
Everywhere.
Everywhere, yeah.
And the two poor lads who were doing this yesterday, they're not out there making major drugs money. These are addicted to a substance that's destroying their lives. So recreational drug users could be able to access, now this is lighter, I know it's not heroin, in an off-licence style outlet in a bid to control the makeup of the drugs and limit the availability of drug guns to make vast fortunes, which we know they're doing. So if you take hash away and cannabis away from the drug gangs, It's big smoke.
This is the thing. It is big smoke, and you target that revenue that they bring
exactly.
in off of that, which is probably, we don't know the exact figures on it, but probably the majority of it, because it is something that becomes a little more socially acceptable. There's a lot of people who do drugs recreationally and do them very casually, and that is where they make a huge amount of that money. There's also the other thing is that at the moment there's no regulation of it. And this is what James Lawless was pointing out. Anything could be in it. You know, you don't know what you're buying if you're buying drugs. Whereas if they regulate it and have it in that like a cafe style, what he's talking about is having labels on them that say, right, this is strength one, strength two, as though, in the same way you do with alcohol, that you know, right, this is 40% alcohol, this is 10% alcohol, or whatever. So at least there's a better idea of what people are buying, and perhaps that would also cut down on like the excess deaths that we see every year.
And that's not to say that, you know, cannabis is completely safe, because we all know that people's lives are destroyed by that.
But we're seeing it more and more, and, you know, with different generations coming through, drug use is becoming higher and higher. And when you see, like, another story we're going to be talking about, the price of pints, the price of alcohol, it is... Listen, we'd love to hear from people at home. 0896 111 111. Do you think that the likes of drugs should be decriminalised, treated as a health issue, as opposed to against the law? We would love to get your input on it. And we'd like to hear, you know, this one as well. So the Dublin ambulance service is leaving the public at risk. This is definitely not just Dublin.
No.
This is across the country that, you know, you were hearing wait times for ambulances, which are frightening.
Yeah, really, really scary, and particularly for stuff like the wait times are better for the very serious, like cardiac arrest, those life or death events, but still the Dublin Fire Brigade and the National Ambulance Service, the two bodies that run this, are not meeting anywhere near their targets. Mm-hmm. And it's really interesting, this is on the front page of the Irish Times. Paul Cullen, the health correspondent, has been chasing this report for years. This is a report that was done in 2016, commissioned in 2016, in which Dublin City Council refused to release a number of times.
Couldn't get it
off them, had tried to FOI it a number of times, and now he has the details. And it seems that in all that time, you think, oh, it's a report for 2016, surely there's been change.
They've improved.
No, there's not. Next month there will be a meeting of a new body that is kind of tasked with bringing all these groups together to make make things more efficient. And what they're saying essentially is resources. So the likes of Rural Ireland, for example, it's the National Ambulance Service who would run that. And it's a little, and the report says this, it's a little bit more understandable there that if you were trying to get somewhere in, you know, the back arse of nowhere, it is going to take you longer to get there. Still not acceptable, but you can understand some of the wait times there. Whereas in Dublin, there's none of those excuses. And there just seems to be an awful lot of overlap. In some areas, it's better than it was. Prior to 2015, for example, there were 9 different bodies managing ambulances, which seems absolutely crazy. So now there is only 2. But both of them are saying, look, we are under-resourced. We don't have the response times. And in 3,000 cases last year, the Irish Times reports, a fire tender was sent out instead of an ambulance, albeit with a paramedically trained fireman in it, but because there was no one else available.
I just think it's interesting that maybe the bodies themselves are... Dublin City Council didn't want to release this. Mm. They're probably happy this is released. Going, please help us. Give us resources.
Well, that's because, I remember hearing during over January, because they couldn't get people into A&E. Mm. The full shift that they're doing for 12 hours was spent with just a patient in the back of the ambulance because they couldn't do the handover. Yeah. So all of a sudden, people out there who are needing an ambulance, who are really in a sick position, couldn't get...
It's the whole health service.
Again, it's just this knock-on.
They're sitting outside hospitals when they could be going out and helping people.
Yeah. Just very quickly, the driving test backlog isn't going to be cleared until mid-2024.
So no ambulance drivers there.
There's no one coming through. Are you waiting for a test, by the way? What's going on? 896 111 111 Because I've heard all people do not like going, I need it for my job, like trying to get their bosses to be like, you need your car.
Are you still allowed to drive in a provisional?
Not without a licensed driver in the car.
Okay. So I think I pretty much grew up driving on a provisional license back in the day.
Because we couldn't get it.
Get signed up for a test. Yeah.
And there's one that needs to... I didn't hear whether it was raised at the committee yesterday, but there was a problem before where even if you were delayed, they weren't updating the NCT, so it was backdated to whenever you were supposed to have it. So if you had to wait 9 months, you only had then 3 months of valid NCT and you had to go again and wait your other 9 months. So hopefully that will get sorted. But mid-2024. We looked it up yesterday on our local one to see when the next appointment is, and it's September.
Okay.
So it's not... You're talking 8 months.
Okay. So let us know what's going on. If at the end of December there were 47,364 learner drivers waiting for an appointment to sit a driving test.
375,000 vehicles overdue their NCT.
Is this all Eamon Ryan going, great, they have to use public transport. Yeah. It's all working out.
My goodness.
People are still going to be using the car, you know, and then you come across a guard who's not a little bit lenient and then suddenly you're paying a fine, or as you could be put off the road if you've already got your fines, you know. So it does, like, there is a more...
There's a knock-on effect. 0896 111 111
Just quickly again, touch on then the publicans. I mean, they just can't seem to take any more blows.
No. And Hugh Horrigan going to be well known to people in the Boar's Head, telling the Irish Mirror he's not happy about it, that they're trying not to pass on all these costs, but of course they have to pass on the costs. And everyone is sort of saying it. Diageo are saying, well, we tried to absorb the costs and now we've put them into the pint of Guinness because they are facing increased cost of goods as well. Interesting that a lot of publicans bulk bought Guinness prior to Christmas so that they wouldn't be taking effect of the new charges. So there will be places where this won't be immediately passed on, but obviously that's going to run
out. How much is Guinness going up by?
Around 6 euro. It costs around 6 euro most bars. 17 for the increase.
A pint. I can't remember, was that the Guinness or the Heineken figure? But it's about 6 euro a pint now before the increases.
Okay.
So you're talking 6.20, 6.30, depending on where you go. Could be 6, 8 euro
either,
you know.
12 euro, that's around Six Nations next weekend.
Yeah.
Sean Defoe from Bauer Media, thank you as always for joining us. And we'd love to hear from you at home, 0896 111 111.
And you're going to see Sean Bauer in a very... Sean Defoe in a... You're going to see Sean Defoe in an interesting light in just a little while.
24.
Stay tuned for that. Alan, what's on the way?
Yes, because coming up, we're celebrating 10-year anniversary of the internet, meaning the Harlem Shake, with some moves of our own. And Paul Ryder is going to run through the biggest online trends. Don't go anywhere. You don't want to miss this after the break. Oh my God. Now, we haven't lost our minds, guys. That was to celebrate 10 years of the viral Harlem Shake dance.
None of us have seen that.
We haven't seen that either. That was our first time to see it.
Before the show, we're all like, what's happening here to talk us through some other iconic viral trends? And he was in said video. Paul Ryder, welcome. That's it. We're done now. That's our career.
That's it. The career's done. The Ballymount Shake will now take over.
The Ballymount Shake.
Yes, we love it.
Well, Tommy, are you happy?
Love it.
Where's
Tommy,
your head?
By the way, Tommy was the horse. There he is. Tommy was the horse.
Who's taking the horse to France, huh?
We were very giddy this morning.
Oh, I love it.
Oh, we were giddy up there.
Not before 7 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
We could see what Harlem Shake, 10-year anniversary. What is it?
10-year anniversary. You're going back to May 2012 when the single was released. It was a producer called Bauer who had released the single, The Harlem Shake. And like all these things, 6 months later, somebody on the internet, a personality called Filthy Frank, decided that he was going to dance on his own and then in the next clip bring in all his mates. And for some reason, that just kicked off. This is way before TikTok, way before Instagram. Yeah. Over 4,000 Harlem Shake videos a day were being uploaded by February 2013. So a month later, 4,000 people. And like I say, the trend is you start on your own, you're having a little boogie, you might be wearing a mask, you might be doing something else, and then all of a sudden, all your mates have joined in. But, like, so many people have taken up this trend. Like, you know, there's huge people in the world who are starting to do these.
Yeah.
Across the world, we're just taking up the Harlem Shake trend. You can see one there, but like mad celebrities, every single TV show
did their own version of it. Yeah.
And across the world had their own version of it. And it was just kind of fun thing to
do. Not a patch on the Ballymount version now.
Not a patch on the Ballymount Shake.
Not a patch. The Ireland AM one was definitely the
best. We're Ireland AM, the stage musical. Forget the toy show. That's what we're going to do. Bored Gosh, taking over. Can you imagine that? So hugely successful.
Like, hugely successful.
I remember that being a huge, because nowadays you get 4,000 videos a second.
Yeah.
It was massive.
But like that was 4,000 people who were uploading their own
versions. Yeah, 4,000 people who were actually got together and did that with a group of people.
The Harlem Shake had nothing to do. There was no kind of outside, you know, somewhere for charity and you're kind of raising money for charity, which we'll move on to
which
next.
Move
the
on
Harlem
to now,
Shake
yeah.
was wasn't
just
one of those.
Fun.
It was just a bit of crack. I even took part in my own with a load of drag queens once. It was good crack.
Like, it's good fun.
Yeah, it is good fun.
For the anniversary, I'd highly recommend it to people at work today.
Let's bring it all back today.
We had so much fun this morning. People were excited to do this. We were talking about a charity one, and this one really did take off around the world. It's the Ice Bucket Challenge, which was for MND in Europe, obviously, motor neuron disease.
Yeah, in America, it was for ALS, which is amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, which is what I know. Yeah, thanks. I got that. I was like, I'll just say it and hope for the best. But here in Europe, and especially in Ireland, it was for motor neuron disease. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it does exactly what it says in the tin. You were to dump a bucket of ice over yourself.
Is that Martin?
And then
Martin King.
Yeah, but we all did it here on the show.
Oh, all right. Well, Alan fuming we're not showing his.
Where's our ones?
It kicked off. It was Matt Lauer on Greg Norman, who's a professional golfer. He called out Matt Lauer to do it, who was an American TV host.
Who's been called out in numerous ways then.
Yes, but he called out for him to do it. And you have 24 hours once you've been called out to take part in the challenge.
Yeah.
And then you nominate 3 more people to do it. And then you donate money towards the charity.
It was amazing. It raised over $115 million.
$150 million
in America.
And $1.6 million alone here.
It was incredible. Yeah,
which is great. But like that again, everybody was doing it, and all you wanted to do was see these high class celebrities all done up to the nines and get thrown,
and then getting the bucket of ice thrown over them. Yeah,
yeah. I'd watch your one over and again and again.
And okay, we don't know what you do at night at home, Paul. Whatever you need, whatever
now,
you need.
Tell us, and moving on to planking.
Oh God.
Yeah, like this one again has no real like there was no message behind it. There was no moment to do it.
It literally is
all just of you lying down, face down, arms to the side, feet straight out, and just like a wooden plank. But you had to beat your friends. I'm a dance teacher and I teach to stage schools. We and my kids used to have a thing who could do the better plank.
But so like, you would like, so do you have to lie like between two? You couldn't just lie on the floor, do you?
Well, you could lie on the floor.
You could, but
you
it wouldn't
lie
have
on the
been...
floor, but then I would imagine Tommy would lie across here, and then I can imagine Mirren...
Sorry,
Tommy
I'm not even... Okay, like, why are we even bothering? He's jumping.
So is that what you mean?
This is what I mean.
That's what you can do.
This is what
I'm sorry. I love that
we've
got our mannequin over there. That's
easy. So you just lie on a thing.
You lie in it. but it's about getting better than your mate. So obviously he would lay down on the floor. Tommy lies in the breakfast bar. Mirren lies across the couch here, and then whoever can do the better one, or else Mirren would be on top of the building, be like, "Ha ha, I win."
Now speaking of that, there was debts about that. Yeah.
There was
people have died because
a young
of this.
Man in Australia who he was trying to do the best job he could, and he lay across a balcony and he fell off when his friends were trying to take a picture. So, again, you have to be really careful and stuff like that. And people were getting called out to be like, "Oh, that's taking it a bit too far."
Well, yeah,
but it is that's a lot of things when you do people take.
Yeah. Okay. We're going to get through them. The mannequin challenge.
Again, nothing to do. It was literally just you had to stand in a room as people went around with your camera and you couldn't move. We did one during Panto one year.
This was huge. And like, is this Hillary Clinton's one?
This is Hillary Clinton's one, which came out on the election day. So yeah, you would literally just stand there, not move. And a camera would go around you and you just had to look like a mannequin.
This was really good. Actually, I remember how it ends. And it was... I actually went down a rabbit hole of these.
Isn't and this was like, don't do this on voting day, wasn't it? She was saying, get out and vote.
Don't stand still, get out and vote. Bill Clinton was in this, obviously. Bon Jovi was in it at the end. There was so many different people.
Bon Jovi, we just spotted him.
And there's Bill.
He actually looks like a waxwork.
He looks like his waxwork from Madame Tussauds.
He does, doesn't he? And there she is herself.
She is the queen herself.
With Huma Abedin.
Okay, flossing.
Flossing is a dance move which took over because of Fortnite. Again, people got into trouble because Fortnite is not the game that, you know, you should really be kind of promoting to kids. But there was one kid who started this dance.
Okay, show us how to do it.
Ah, I knew you'd do that.
I know.
It's happening on screen. So you're
trying to... We'll all do it.
So you basically have to move your hands to your hips to the opposite side. So you're kind of like, this is the... Oh, you're doing it really well. Mirren actually has it down.
What do you do? So you move your hips...
You're forward and backing, basically. Tommy.
Come on.
This is the sort of stuff he'd be doing on tour buses
but
all the time
listen,
now.
This one kind of took over because, like, there was parents getting in trouble. But, like, his kids were using it in the schoolyard and they wouldn't even stand talking to teachers. They would just stand there doing the flossing while teachers were talking to them. The likes of Kate Garraway got involved. There were so many different people who were kind of getting involved.
But that's an easy one to do, like, to get involved in.
But then schools and all were giving out then. You know, typical teachers were like, "Oh, no, you can't be doing that in the schoolyard." And then they kind of ruined it. But the kids are still doing it. If it's not those TikTok moves that you see them doing in shopping centres, they're flossing around.
They're flossing around.
The memories. What's next? God only knows.
Paul Ryder, a pleasure to have you in. And thank you for taking part in our Harlem Shake. That's something we're going to live to regret.
That'll be up online later on. We've lots more still to come in Ireland and we'll see in a few minutes.
Welcome back. You're watching Ireland AM on Virgin Media One.
Coming up shortly, we're going to hear the story of a Waterford man who was diagnosed with three different forms of cancer before he turned 40. Inspirational man. Incredible.
Looking forward to it. And from Brendan Fraser's Oscar tip performance in The Whale to a candid new documentary on Pamela Anderson where she gets to tell her own story for the first time. Brian Lloyd is rounding up the best movies and TV on offer this weekend.
Alan is standing by in the kitchen. Al, what have we got to look forward to?
Yes, the wonderful Alberto Rossi is here and we've a sweet treat lined up this morning. What have you got for us, Alberto?
We have a chiacchiere. It's such a big word,
Chiacchiere. Am I saying it right? Chiacchiere.
Yes, and I like the hand gesture too.
Tell us what chiacchiere is.
It's a typical sweet.
But what does it mean, chiacchiere?
Oh, it means chit-chat.
When you chat
to somebody, you know, it's just chiacchiere.
So you're chiacchiering.
You know? Exactly.
Chiacchiering.
You know?
Chit-chat.
So it's very nice.
And so you put them, you deep-fry them.
Yeah, we're going to deep-fry them,
So it's lovely and healthy.
Absolutely.
Really? Come on.
Especially in the morning.
Especially in the morning. We're going, so stay with us for chiacchiere later on. Now, Deric is unleashing his inner White Walker. Deric, how are you getting on?
I do not know who you speak of. I am Jon Snow, House of Stark and King of the North. Beyond the wall, as we assemble our troops to fight the army of the dead. And look who we have found, three new recruits, Mirren, Tommy and Alan. Let the battle commence.
I love it, Jon Snow.
Jon Snow, but also Paul Daniels. He's got real magician moves going on
there. I want to go there.
That is...
Love it, Derek.
That's it. Harlem Shake. I am looking forward to Deric having that accent on all morning. That's going to be fantastic.
It's great to have you back. Now, after facing three types of cancer, Dr. Brian Tobin was advised by doctors to undergo genetic testing. The results showed Brian to possess an extremely rare genetic disorder, predisposing him to developing cancer.
And we're joined by Brian this morning. Thank you so much for coming in, Brian. It's a pleasure to have you here. Can we talk about, because you are a young fella and you've had cancer three times. So can we go back to when you were 19 years old? What happened?
Yeah, so I just had a lot of pain around the left hemipelvis. Was kind of
where's the hemipelvis? A
hip femur, just, that whole
area. Yeah, so it is. Yeah.
So just urinating a lot more than usual. And which is unlike me, I had to like leave important exams to go to the toilet, which I don't usually do because I like exams. So I knew something was wrong and I was doubled up by the end of it, actually, just couldn't walk properly or anything. So it took a long time and many scans to find a bone tumour in the pelvis. Okay. And that was the first one.
So you were only 19 at that age. I mean, so young. Yeah. When they found that bone tumour, did you have to go to London for them to find it, or was it you just had the surgery over there?
Just the surgery there. It was discovered here in Dublin, actually, at St. James's. But yeah, they sent me to London because the surgery here, the option was amputation, whereas they do limb salvage in London for something like that. So I was very fortunate to find them.
And what impact did that have then?
It was really difficult afterwards because it was hard to learn to walk again, and there was some associated infection as well. There's a lot of metal in there, essentially, keeping me together.
Okay.
So yeah, it was quite an impact, emotionally, physically, and all of that.
How long did it take you to learn how to walk again?
I was using a wheelchair or crutches for a number of years afterwards, actually. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
It was that much of an impact?
Oh, yeah, it was phenomenal, but the end result was well worth it.
And chemo, was that a part of it as well then?
It was initially. So in 2002, I had a lot of chemotherapy prior to that surgery.
Okay.
But none since, thankfully.
So you're kind of sitting there going, okay, I've had a really bad bone cancer at 19 years old. It's taken me years to recover from. Mm. And then you are doing your thing, you're doing law, like, I mean, you've got your undergrad, your postgrad, your master's, your doctorate.
Yeah.
And you were in Italy. Yeah. And what happened?
Yeah, I was really unwell coming back from Italy, developed sepsis over there. I think it was due to the water, actually. But so I was really unwell when I came back and had to go to hospital for treatment for sepsis. But they actually discovered this really large mole on my right ankle, which I'd taken no notice of. Mm. But it was already a high-grade melanoma, so skin cancer, essentially. And that involved more surgery. So extraction of the mole and a lot of the tissue and around it and skin.
For the melanoma? Was that bad?
Yeah, it was a really big one. And I had a graft from my left thigh to my right ankle. So
was it the same leg? Like, did they try and link the cancer? Because at that stage, I think we had not 7 years in remission.
Yeah, I was. Yeah, that was 2014. So an awful long time later. But no, they so the hemipelvis was the left side. This was the right side. There was nothing to really link the two, bone tumor or skin cancer at the time. But it was when in 2018 I developed another one on the arm. It grew from the size of a pea to a golf ball in less than 6 weeks, about 5 weeks.
So when you saw it as the pea, were you like, there's something up here already?
Yeah, the feel of it even, like...
Oh, there you are.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my God, look at that.
That's after surgery, the other pick. So
and the pick is how big it got.
Oh, yeah, in a very short space of time.
So, Brian, you've beaten it once at the age of 19. You've come back, you've got the melanoma, you've managed to thankfully move on from that, and then find it again, a third form of cancer.
Yeah.
In how many years?
So overall, over the course of 16 years, there was a very long gap between the first and second one, 2002 to 2014, but between the second and third, 14 to 18, only 4 year gap.
Okay.
And actually, I'm being investigated at the moment for a small lump on the right flank. So.
My goodness.
Having a biopsy next week. So
how do you deal with this? Because you hear of people who go through cancer, one form of cancer, and the impact it has, long-lasting impact, mentally and physically.
Yeah.
How do you keep building yourself up to go through it again?
I think I've had it so many times now that it's like having to have some dental work done to me, you know, just something.
What?
I know it's sad to say, it's almost kind of routine, you know? But like, I've got my family and small group of friends that keep me going, and I love my work. My work is okay. Very important.
But okay, so we're talking about, were you 35, 36 by the time you had three forms of cancer?
Yeah, yeah.
Who went, there's something going on here, these have to be connected? Who said, like, what's going on?
Yeah, I was on sabbatical in London at the time, and the consultant there, who was actually involved in my pelvis as well, he was like, let's do some genetic testing on you, because there are three different forms. This was a soft tissue tumour on the arm, the really crazy one, but they're very aggressive. They grow really quickly and they can spread.
So they discovered that you have a syndrome. What is it?
Yeah, it's called Lee-Fraumeni syndrome. It's extremely rare. About 50 people in every million have it. And it's even more rare with myself because I'm not from what's called a Lee-Fraumeni family. It usually runs in families, whereas I'm the first in my family in whom it has manifested.
So it's not genetic? Okay.
It's not genetic.
Well, it must be great that you're like the rest of your family don't have it.
Yeah, that's it, exactly, yeah.
Can they explain why you got it then?
Not necessarily. You can be what's called a de novo case, you know, new Lee-Fraumeni, you're just born with it. Or it can be brought on by environmental factors, but there's not much research to show exactly.
Okay.
But it's interesting.
How does it impact your life now? I mean, even in terms of knowing that it is genetic, with the treatment that you've had, are you able to have children? Is it something that you would even like to try if knowing that this could be passed on?
Yeah, so it would be very likely to be passed on. The genetic counsellors told me that. The diagnosis of Lee-Fraumeni syndrome was a real comfort to me, actually, because I finally had an answer.
Okay.
You know, that there was a genetic problem, I suppose, so to speak. The way to have children, if I ever wanted to do that, would be through pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, where the embryos are formed in a clinical setting and tested for...
Oh, if you wanted to have biological children?
Yeah, yeah, and then you could discard any embryo that's found to have...
Okay.
They can do that?
Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it?
That is amazing.
The law isn't in place in this country
That's
yet.
What I was thinking. Yeah, I was like,
other area of expertise.
That doesn't sound like... And you were in family law.
Yeah, yeah.
So he knows what he's able to do in here.
But that's one way of doing it.
Do you find, like, did you find... Because you just kept saying, I love my job. Mm. You know, you've done your master's, your PhDs, the whole lot. Did you find that was a release, a way to almost to distract yourself from the cancers and the treatments that you're having to go through?
Oh, definitely, yeah. Because when I had the first surgery, the surgeon told me from now on, like, contact sports were out, but they were never really in for me anyway. you know the kid at GAA camp who gets the best effort prize? That was me.
Hey, listen, they're very important. Tell you what, it's not about winning, Brian, it's about taking part.
Yeah, that's
hey, listen, you can wear a rugby player's brand, you're fine, it's the same thing. Don't worry about it.
Best dressed man here.
There we go.
But that is it. Like, so the sport was out, which is something you obviously were involved in, you enjoyed. So you thought you had to throw yourself into something else.
Yeah, well, I was always like a big nerd anyway, so it quite suited me to do a lot of studying. And then because when you're immobilised, it's really handy to just have books in front of you and a laptop and do your things. So.
And from this point of view, having this rare disorder, you're saying you found an awful lot of solace. Was there a time of anger, of going, why me?
Between 2002 and 2020, actually, as these started to pop up more and more, and you know, even the specialists were putting it down to bad luck, really, you know, before the genetic testing. And I was starting to get a bit angry with, you know, the world, life, whatever, you know.
Yeah.
So as I say, I've taken great comfort in the diagnosis, even though the future is uncertain.
But you, I assume, have to be incredibly vigilant. You are checking yourself all of the time.
Yeah, yeah.
And is that just part of your routine?
Not really, but sometimes you stumble upon something. As I say, recently this has kind of come up now, but hopefully it's just another one that can be quickly dealt with.
Wow. Is it a cancer?
They think it is, as of Tuesday of this week, so just 48 hours ago. Next week we'll confirm. And I must say, though, I've been very fortunate thus far in many respects. I've had, you know, early correct diagnoses, which is always hugely important, and I've never had secondaries. So these have all been... Lone Rangers, where they've popped up and have been able to be dealt with.
So, having gone through this and what you are currently going through, you're incredibly inspirational even to come on and be so upbeat about it. It's amazing. In terms of people who have cancer or people, young people who are watching this even now, like, have you any advice for them? Like, what should they do?
I think if you're a young person, especially in your teens or early 20s, and you're diagnosed with a serious form of cancer, I would say to you to speak to your consultant about genetic testing. I would like to have had it done earlier to have that kind of solace going forward. So that would be my advice. And to just do what works for you when you're going through it. You know, you'll have hopefully family support, friends, studies, career you love, whatever, but do what works for you.
Yeah.
Very, very important. Absolutely. And listen, it is working for you. You're incredible. You're lecturing at the moment in NUIG. Yeah. I'm sure your students are watching this. Well, they probably shouldn't be, actually. They should be studying hard. I'm sure you're an inspiration to them as well, knowing what you've been through as well. It's just amazing. Brian Tobin, thank you so much. Tobin, apologies.
That's okay. Thanks
very much. The doctor was like, I don't know if I'll be able to talk. And I'm like, you talk in front of hundreds of students all the time. This is not as scary as students, hopefully.
No, not at all.
A pleasure to meet you. Thank you so much for
coming.
Thank
you very much.
Cheers.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
We have lots more Ireland M coming up very shortly.
Now, Alberto Rossi is here with us and whipping up an Italian treat. Good morning to you, Alberto.
Good morning,
Alan. What's it called again?
Chiacchiere.
Chiacchiere.
Yes.
Chiacchiere.
Yeah,
that's it.
See, Tommy was in Rome last week.
Chiacchiere.
He was doing all the chiacchiere last week.
Big time.
Yeah, he was chit-chatting
away.
I tell you what, I bloody love Italian food. It's
very good.
So
delighted.
Good.
I get to keep my job.
We didn't have any chiacchiere, though, but next time...
No, you were doing time. A lot of chatting.
Because the chiacchiere are usually served around the carnival season in Italy, so that will be in about a few days because it just starts before Lent. It ends before Lent, so it starts on the 5th. And it goes on until the 24th.
I'd love to go to the one in Venice. I believe it's amazing.
It's beautiful. It's beautiful. With all the different masks and everything, it's brilliant, you know?
So
and
obviously, how do we start it?
We have flour. So the recipe, I'm making just a half a recipe, but the recipe is a half a kilo of 00 flour that
half
you can
kilo?
Find. Half a kilo, 500 grams.
Okay. Oh, yeah. I was thinking of a massive big bag. I was going to say,
a big spoon. You know? So we have flour, we have caster sugar, we have baking powder, we have eggs, we have a bit of lemon zest, and then you have butter and you have vanilla if you can find it. Otherwise, you can
It's quite sweet pasta.
Yeah, it's not as sweet. Like, let's say for 500 grams.
Are you going to mix it?
Yeah. Then? For 500 grams of flour, there is only 60 grams of sugar, so it's not powerfully sweet.
Okay.
But then you finish it with icing sugar once you fry them. So you start it, you know, you can see a paddle. It's easier with the mixer. You know, with the hands, it's not that good, but like everybody now has a mixer at home and you can just make
it. Not everybody now, Alberto.
Most of the people.
You should
now, I did this by hand yesterday.
I don't have a mixer at home. Well, I never bake, so it doesn't matter.
You can take these home. So we have here the dry stuff, and then I just add inside the eggs. And you let it mix, and then once it starts to mix like that, the eggs gets absorbed, it looks a little bit dry, then we add the butter, and the butter will make it nice and get together,
This takes you to take your time at this.
Yeah, it takes about 7 to 8 minutes.
This is the love and care of the Italian.
Exactly. This is, while you're doing this, you have to shout over the machine at the wife, you know, that's the conversation, you know? Because it's always like that. When you're in the kitchen, you have to be loud, 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 you know?
What?
But you don't be loud in your kitchen. We have to say congratulations to the Intercontinental Hotel.
Thank you very much,
Alan. What did they win?
Well, we won 5-star hotel of the year for Ireland.
5-star hotel of the year for Ireland.
I know, we are delighted.
And look at you there on stage, all down to your cooking, Alberto, yeah?
Some of it, I would like to take 100% of it, but no, it's down to the whole team. We were so chuffed. Obviously, there was only 4 of us there on Tuesday night in Galway, but we brought this back to the team, and it's fantastic.
You know,
we're the Virgin Media Awards.
Yes, the Virgin Media Awards.
Yeah. Well, we should be
delighted.
There.
We were already shocked, you know. But
we had no say in it at all.
But that's amazing, because we're very fortunate in Ireland. Some unbelievable 5-star hotels.
That's
so to
indeed,
win that.
That's indeed. So thank you
well
very
done.
Much for that.
The Dickie Bow and all was on.
Okay, exactly. The bow tie was on, yeah, the Dickie Bow.
So as you can see, the dough starts to get together. And then I have one that I did yesterday, so I come already prepared. And it kind of gets, it's not too hard. Okay.
So would it take about 7 minutes?
Yeah, 7 minutes. Take it out and you put it all together, put in the fridge 30 minutes to rest, because that is the baking powder then makes action, okay?
Is it flour or is it dough or kind of like a pastry?
It's dough.
It's
dough. It will be like any dough, you know, like a sweet dough, but obviously not as sweet.
Okay.
And then what happens is that you use a little rolling pin to make it thin, yeah. Okay? And I already made it thin, and I have my pasta machine just because it helps me to make it a little bit... Any chance that I have to bring it out. And you make it very thin like that, okay?
Oh. And if then, you don't have a pasta machine now,
you can still use the rolling pin, works very well because.
It takes some rolling out to get from that to
that. But like the smaller you cut it,
you just cut it up like that. Yeah.
So you have a small piece.
The whole big piece.
No, exactly. You can do piece by piece. You know, you gotta make it easy for yourself. Okay. So once it comes out and is here nice and thin, you know, what happened is we have to cut it like 10 by 5 centimeters or anything that's kind of rectangular. So I cut them like this.
Okay.
And then I have my special pastry cutter, the one it's fluted, you call it, you know, that's not straight.
Oh, okay.
You know, and you cut two or three little lines in between, so there's air in between.
Why is that?
It just, when it fries and everything, the oil goes through, otherwise they retain all the oil in it.
Okay.
And then we have here oil. So this is just vegetable oil in a pan.
Uh-huh.
And we're going to start to have it hot. Now, we got to always be careful when we are doing open frying like this, lots of oil. It's easier. You can't do this in an air fryer now. Don't go mad trying to fry this in an air fryer.
Don't do it.
They don't work.
Okay.
No, I never tried, but I tell you, don't
try.
They're not going to work.
This is for the carnival. It's a special occasion.
You need a big pot of oil.
Okay, right.
So then you drop them in, and you know they don't take that long to cook. You see, they start ready to pop. All the air is inside, so they are nice and light. Now, it takes about a minute.
I'd say a lot of people watching this are kind of like, what's it going to look like? Or what's... So this is a dessert.
Dessert is a big word. You have these during the day. You know, you go in a bakery and you can buy them. Yeah, like sweet crisps, you know, sweet dough.
So would you just have these in the house and you take them out like you'd have a biscuit or something?
Exactly, absolutely. Okay. You know, you go up to the local baker and everybody's doing them, you know? And then in different regions of Italy, they're called in different names. So you see, they come out like that.
That's fast, isn't
it? You put them on a little bit of paper so they absorb all the excessive oil and there's no messing. And then, obviously, I made some in advance.
Okay.
You know, I can show you how they come out.
Mm.
Obviously, I just put them here to make them pretty. But as you can see... Yeah, you dust a little bit of sugar on top of it just at the end.
That's more than a little bit. Now, exactly. What kind of sugar is that? Is that caster?
Icing sugar.
Okay, Look at that. And what else? What's the yellow
bit? I just finished with a little bit of lemon zest. Because it brings a bit of more of the smell.
Wow.
And, you know?
Okay, so this is
very light, very crispy. Messy.
Mm. Yeah, messy.
You know, it makes the noise when you're eating, you know?
Oh, they're sweet though.
Very sweet because you put all the sugar on it, you know?
Yeah.
So they're very, like, we grew up eating these.
Yeah,
absolutely. You know, you go to the local baker and, you know, after you play football all day, that's exactly what you need. Now, always this little period of February, the carnival, so you only have a certain window.
They will only make these
for this carnival? Absolutely, yes.
So you don't get them all year round?
You don't get them all year round.
And would people in Italy like look forward to this period where they go and buy them in the shops?
Absolutely. I was making them yesterday in work, and obviously I always try test things, you know, and then I give them to the guys in work, you know, to check. But thank God they always tell me it's great.
I love that when I...
But some of the Italian guys that work with us say, exactly like my mama used to do, you know? The light that I got, the tick, you know, it's very good.
So for all our Italian viewers,
Chiacchiere.
Happy carnival.
Exactly.
Alberto Rossi, congratulations on your award.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for the hotel and your award.
Thank you.
Now we have lots more Ireland M on the way after this short break.
No, we haven't gone mad. You are watching Ireland AM. It's a Thursday morning.
He's our wee donkey. Can we make it
from the Banshees of Inishearn?
Yeah, I tell you.
Little Jenny. Can I just say,
I love doing that.
Everything else that we were wearing, it was the 10th anniversary of the Harlem Shake, but everything else we were wearing in that was from our wardrobe box upstairs. Tommy owns the horse's head. Yes. That's your
he
horse's head, isn't
it?
Isn't
it? Me,
like,
yeah.
You brought it with you from the house.
I was so excited to do this, honestly. They're all, like, discussing real serious matters in the meeting yesterday. I said, are we doing the Harlem Shake? No.
We were actually on the WhatsApp group a while ago, and we were like, going, oh, listen, this is happening. And then Tommy goes, 10th anniversary of Harlem Shake is coming up. And we were talking about some legislation. He was like, we were like, OK.
Wait till we do the ice bucket challenge and get you again, Al.
No, thanks.
Aoife has sent in a message. Oh, my God, I completely forgot about the Harlem Shake until I saw you doing it this morning. I remember doing it on my last day of school with the rest of the class. It's been reminded me of good times.
There you go. That's what it's about. And George said, love the Harlem Shake video this morning. Tommy was hilarious. It was obviously he was very excited about it. Very excited. Great to see the crew and all the guests getting involved. I can't stop watching it. So they're obviously rewinding and watching it.
Have you been married 10 years?
I actually couldn't believe that there's that many people put the show on the road.
So yeah, when you see them all in the studio,
I felt bad. It's like, oh, yes, you're anything
else. When everyone came out.
And
thank you to all of the crew who got involved this morning.
For keeping me happy.
Very good.
Keeping Tommy very happy on the bank holiday.
Discussing.
And now we go back to something completely different.
A lot of other things this morning we've discussed already this morning, one of which was the Taoiseach, Micheál Martin, talking about, well, he don't know if he said he condoned it completely, but talking about the decriminalisation of drugs. And John has said a message. I understand the logic of decriminalising drugs. However, as it would be more accessible for people, I think it would encourage those who have never tried drugs to try them. And there is that, absolutely.
Well, Ciarán Carey was writing last year in the paper about how GAA clubs are awash with drugs. They're
But it's not something you want to be promoting either.
No, I absolutely get that.
Let everybody say, oh, I'm going to try it. I mean, it's not something
that... But I think that they are almost as accessible as though they're legal. Like, it's so easy to get them.
But they are accessible, but there'll be a lot of people who wouldn't take them. But then when they become decriminalised, they kind of feel like they have to do it.
Tell me, you either want to do it or you're not. If it's decriminalised, you're not going to say, oh, I have to do it.
We have a massive drug problem now. Why not get the tax from smoking cannabis?
Yeah. I mean, cannabis, but you do get the smell of it walking around cities.
I feel high as a kite.
Yeah.
High as a kite.
It's amazing. You're walking down the street and you go, has someone just passed me, and you're looking around.
But it's when it's 8 o'clock in the morning and you're like standing at a traffic light and you smell it and you're like, this is what someone wants to have a smoke.
Well, here you go.
Before they go to work.
Sharon has said, I'm all in favour of decriminalising cannabis. However, a recent trip to New York where the drug is legalised resulted in me wearing a mask due to the stench from people using the drug. So there's the smell. Imagine what it'd be like if it was decriminalised. It was disgusting. It would turn me off going to New York again. If you are not a smoker and you don't want to be exposed to this substance on every street in Ireland, so there needs to be consideration of the non-smoking public.
Well, this is true. I don't smoke, never have, and it does sort of... I can sense somebody when I'm smoking.
But it was like that with, like, when you smell a cigarette now a street, you're like, but I... Honestly, there's not... I feel all you smell is cannabis in Dublin.
Well, it would be a lot worse if it was decriminalised.
Well, you don't know that, Tommy.
No, I think it's as bad as it is. We were also talking about mother and baby homes. Of course, there is a huge issue with the redress scheme where 24,000 people are not going to be included because they spent less than 6 months in a mother and baby institution. Colleen says, I was in a mother and baby home for over 2 years and then they sent me to America where I wasn't in a safe home. I moved home 4 years ago with the hope of meeting my siblings, which will never happen. My birth mom passed away. I think the government needs to include all babies and mothers in the scheme. There should be no discrimination. This experience will follow me and others for my life. And money does not take that pain away. So please do the right thing. And speaking to Noelle
earlier, I mean, that was the thing we were asking. And it's not about the money. It's not about the $5,000. It's not about, you know, the medical card, I think, would be very helpful. Because it's the trauma that these people have been through and that lives with them forever. But really, listen to Noelle talk. But like, anytime she goes into the doctor, you're asked, have you got a family history? She doesn't know.
No. Yes.
So you're always on the back foot for everything.
Yeah. I don't know what my family history is. Yeah. And Brendan says,
the sliding scale kind of pits people against each other on it.
Absolutely.
Those of us adopted in under 6 months are now being treated as lesser than those over 6 months. Again, the government of Ireland managed to take those labelled as second class all our lives and now places as third class citizens.
It's so upsetting. And Noelle, which she didn't get to say on air, the money
when everyone's like, well, is this, it's not all about money, but that money is for people who have severe conditions now as a result of this. We have spoken to mothers whose backs are broken. They worked in really hard conditions, but psychologically, who have to pay for counselling every single year because they don't have the full medical card. That's what it's for. There are people who are in very bad ways for this. So you can write, if it's something you feel strongly about, you can write to your TDs because it still hasn't gone to the Shannon yet. It's time for a very quick break now. But we've got lots more on the way. Welcome back to Ireland AM. Over the next hour, we have got plants, performers, and Puss in Boots.
Move over, Jon Snow. We have our very own Khaleesi. Deric is going to be coming live from Westeros very shortly.
He's been trying to cultivate the Jon Snow King in the North thing all morning.
He's got the voice as well.
And your good Mother of Dragons, that's it. And from Brendan Fraser's much-hyped acting comeback to the turn of cinema's most ferocious feline, Brian Lloyd is talking movies at 9:45.
And Alan has a leaf. The studio to learn the value of everyday plants and weeds.
That, Tommy, what has I done?
You've leafed.
You weeds.
Nez, from skincare products to medicine, we'll be learning how everyday plants and weeds have more uses than you might suspect. From Forager Feebee Foran, good morning.
Hello,
to you.
Good morning.
Now, we're saying you're a forager. What's a forager?
Well, a forager is someone who goes out into the wild and finds wild plants to eat or to use in skincare products like I do.
You just have to be careful. You'd have to know what you're doing.
Absolutely.
And you're going to teach us about that.
I'm going to give you all the tips and tricks to get started.
Okay, looking forward to that. That's coming up a little later on now.
Oh, yeah, you're very welcome back.
You are. We've been chatting all morning. We've had very varied things on the show this morning. And I just want to say this one message from Jacqueline, and this is about the mother and baby redress scheme that we were talking about this morning with Noelle, who's a survivor of BESPR. I totally agree that everyone in the mother and baby homes needs to be included, no matter what age or what age they were when they left the mother and baby institution. They spend a lifetime trying to find their information that everyone else has a right to, only to receive redacted pages that tell them nothing. All government bodies that are there to help are dragging their heels with handing over their birth information. Time is of the essence here if we are to ever discover our identities and medical history. Jacqueline, thank you so much for sending in that message.
On another note, we've been discussing an awful lot this morning, from the Harlem Shake to mother and baby homes to driving tests. If you want to get a driving test now, whatever about getting your car checked. Now, if you want to get a driver's test, it might take it to mid-2024 to try and book yourself.
Mid-2024? It's only the start of 2023.
Yes, before you can book yourself in for a test. But Carola said back in the early 80s, there was such a backlog of people waiting for driving tests that they offered it out to people who were on their second provisional licence. They were given a full licence just like that with no test. And there are so many rules and regulations attached to getting a licence these days that it costs a fortune.
To be fair, I think it's kind of important.
I'll send them all out.
But if you're on
like
your
back then,
there was a backlog for us as well. And we in the country, we were able to kind of drive around. And
well, we were allowed to drive in our second provisional without having a licensed driver in the car. Yeah. It was legal back then.
Yeah. So it it's obviously changed now.
But it's not anymore.
But I failed my test because of that, though.
Did you? Sammy said,
well, you pick up so many bad habits, you see.
Oh, totally.
So I was there.
Tommy going around Monaghan, and no, you know.
Do you know when you're going on a one-way street and someone's wanting to get out? So I was kind of going, on you go. Instant fail.
Oh, yeah, you're not allowed to do that in the test.
Yeah, you're meant to stop at lights as well. That was another one.
Sorry, do you know what
you're supposed to stop at lights. You know when it goes red, you're supposed to stop. I did it for the show a couple of years back.
Redid
and
the
I'd failed before I left the test centre.
I've seen you drive.
To be fair, it doesn't surprise me.
No, I failed. I'd done so many things before I left the test centre that I'd already failed.
I also love that Tommy's letting the nation know I failed because I'm such a nice guy. Like, I was letting someone pass across the road when I was doing my
test. That's what it is. You wouldn't fail for that, I'd say.
Sam says, I've had a learner permit for a year and a half and still likely to be waiting about 6 months before I can take my test. It keeps getting pushed back every time I make an appointment. If it gets pushed back again, I'll have to renew my learner's permit before I can take my test, and I'll have to pay to get that renewed. Isn't that just crazy?
Did you pass first time, Al?
I did.
Did you?
Yeah.
And you did, Maren?
When did you do your driving
test? I failed twice.
When did you do your driving test?
Oh,
before they had examiners. They just gave you a car and a license back then.
6 months ago.
Before they'd examine this. Before they'd go, do you know when you went out and you chunked up your car like that?
I thought it was the Flintstones. You just put your legs through.
Yeah, just put your legs through. See what I have to put up with every morning, viewers? This is the abuse I get every morning.
Shall we just quickly talk about the ambulances as well? In that to get an ambulance at the minute has become an absolute fire.
I'm apologising. I want to apologise.
It's become such a problem. Katie, the retrained fire service have crews trained as first responders and cardiac first responders to attend calls where ambulances are delayed or unavailable, but they are not turned out to assist them. These crews should be used to assist when required, but it all comes down to money. If you just think, if you have a really serious situation and you've been told the ambulance is going to be at least half an hour away, or 45 minutes because of the shortage of drivers and shortage of funding.
This report that they released today in relation to the Dublin area that Dublin City Council didn't want to release, it's 27 to 43% of ambulances will not make it on time to a cardiac.
And that report
situation
was 2017, and it's actually gotten worse.
Yeah.
Anyway, now let's move on to something a bit more interesting. Deric is living out his Game of Thrones dreams. Deric, tell us more.
Yes, guys, we are very excited here this morning. Welcome back to Banbridge in County Down. We're on our Game of Thrones studio tour right across the morning. Jessica, local tour guide, but also a massive fan of the show as well.
100%. I'm a huge fan. So I'm really excited. We're actually standing right now in the Great Hall of Winterfell, which is the ancestral home in the show of House Stark. And this is one of my favourite sets in the entire tour, mainly because this set hasn't moved at all since filming. So you're actually standing where they filmed. And
wow.
I know, where all the actors, those iconic scenes happened and everything. It's amazing.
Now, Game of Thrones, a lot of it was filmed up here in Northern Ireland.
Yep, a massive majority was filmed in Northern Ireland, and about 30% was filmed right here in the Game of Thrones studio tour. So we have authentic sets, props and costumes, and it's just amazing for the fans to see and for me to talk about.
And not only that, but you're a local girl here as well, aren't you?
Yep, I'm from Banbridge, and it's amazing. I grew up
watching this.
Yep, the show being right here, and I'm a tour guide. Here, it's amazing.
You've even got tattoos as well of the show.
Yeah, I've got the dragon tattoo.
Oh, look on your... So it's almost like come full circle, hasn't
100%,
it?
Yep.
Now, Connor is joining us now. And Connor, this series has been a massive success for HBO, hasn't it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it was the most popular TV show of all time. And you can definitely see why when you see the kind of quality of the sets and costumes that we have.
Now, we're talking 8 Emmys.
I was going to say, don't know if you could throw on the House of Dragon ones as well, but there are a lot of Emmys, especially in the technical categories, which don't always get a look at the kind of things you see behind
me here. Where are we landed in now?
So we are in Dragonstone. This is the ancestral home of House Targaryen in the show.
Okay.
So Dragonstone features from as early as season 2, and we're lucky enough to actually have one of the most iconic rooms from the show, the map room, along with other parts of Dragonstone, which were actually filmed up in Belfast, but we're very privileged on the tour to have both sets.
Okay, where are we moving to next then?
So what we have here is the Dragonstone throne, which you'd be probably surprised to hear if you are a fan of the show. A lot of people come into the tour and actually prefer the Dragonstone throne to the Iron Throne.
Why so?
I think it's the design, and it's a little bit different. You know, not everyone thinks of it when they think of Game of Thrones. You think of the Iron Throne.
Now, Game of Thrones, we can't talk about it without talking about the costumes, one of which I'm wearing this morning. So much intricate detail in those costumes.
Yes, very many of our guests who come on the tour always make the point to me that the costumes themselves are one of the most impressive parts. They give you a whole new perspective when you ever go rewatch the show, and a greater appreciation for the work that goes into it. And you can only see items like this on the tour itself.
And we had so many Irish actors. We're talking the likes of Jack Gleeson. We're talking Liam Cunningham, Aidan Gillen as well. Big Irish contingent in there.
Oh, yeah, not even just the actors. A lot of the people who actually worked on the show were...
On production.
Exactly that. A lot of people, locals from Northern Ireland, made up a lot of the crew, whether that's people working on set design, costume, props, and a lot of extras. I'd say a lot of people in Northern Ireland probably
featured. Did you end up being an extra?
Unfortunately, no. I couldn't grow enough of a beard at the time, unfortunately.
I'm sorry about that. Yeah. In terms of, we've had 8 seasons, will we see a 9th season?
I don't know about a 9th season. We're getting the prequel show, House of Dragon, at the moment. There are a lot of spin-offs rumoured about there, but you know, you can only cross your fingers.
Okay, well, fingers crossed this morning as well. You've so many visitors coming to do your studio tours as well. We're having a great morning here. Highly, highly recommend. Check them out at GameOfThronesStudioTour.com. That's where you'll find them online. But for now, guys, back to you based in Dublin.
Love this that. Is fantastic.
Thanks, Dracula.
Yeah.
Dracula.
Come to me. Yes.
Thank Love you. That. I was like all morning, does he think it's Harry Potter? Ooh. Is that why he's doing it? It's Dracula.
Dracula. That's what he's Dracula. Doing. Yeah. He's in the wrong place.
Well, they filmed Dracula. They filmed Dracula, I think, up in Belfast as well.
Which one?
They did. One of the big series.
Oh, yeah. The one with Jonathan Rhys-Meyers.
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
They did. Yeah, he's right.
Okay. Anyway, it looks amazing, looks though, if yeah, you're really a does. Fan yeah, of the show. Yeah. Amazing.
Banbridge, just up the M1. Yeah. Should be easy as that.
Tommy's going directly after
I
the
can't
show.
Wait. Yes. Check it out.
That's now, it. After the break, we're going to be foraging and we're going to be looking at what the latest movies are in the cinema this week. Do you know what foraging is? Stay with us. Now, we're outside here because we're doing a bit of foraging with Forager Feebee Foran, learning all about the benefits of wild weeds and trialling some of the skincare products that she's made from them.
Yes, good morning.
Good
Phoebe.
Morning
How
to
are you.
I'm great, I'm great.
Foraging, what is it?
So foraging by its very nature is getting out into the wild and picking wild plants to either eat or use for different reasons. So for me, I make skincare products out of them for using old Irish remedies that would have been passed down from granny to granny to granny and then kind of just stopped and people forgot about them. So I'm kind of on a bit of a mission
there,
to bring
there
back.
There is all those, like all those old wives' tales about you go out and you pick the dock leaves and it gets rid of
yeah,
this
yeah,
and all
absolutely.
Those things.
I've been like, there, done that.
And they've come from somewhere. They've come from somewhere and we just kind of forgot about them. So, like, it's a matter of going, why did they do things the way they did? And, like, the fact of it is that people tended to use their intuition when there wasn't modern medicine to test what does this plant do. They'd literally listened to what the plant had to tell them.
And why did you start it?
Well, for me, 5 years ago, I lost my dad after a very, very short illness, 11 days of cancer, and that was the end of that. And I kind of went into a bit of a deep freeze. Like most people, when they're grieving, you kind of go into this freeze motion. And then as I started to thaw out, I realized that I needed something to ground me. And the one thing that called me was the ground itself.
Okay.
So I started to forage and work with nature and kind of connect with nature in a way that kind of made me feel like, oh, okay, I can trust this. When the rest of the world feels like it's stopped, I feel like I can trust nature because Mother Nature knows what's coming next.
She does. And you call yourself the Green Witch of Fair House. Would that put people
That's Fair House in Tala now,
Fairhouse,
isn't it?
Fairhouse, down, only
around
down
the corner.
Oh, Shore Top.
Why witch? What, like?
Well, so a Green Witch is really somebody who connects with nature and works with animals, with the wildlife, with the birds, and helps people
and
to...
potions.
Yeah, well, potions, but also to helps people to heal and connect using the power of nature. So one of the things that when I do markets and stuff, I generally get asked, are you a good witch? It's always very important to establish this very fast.
And
yes,
I'm sure you are a
I'm
good witch.
You have the best reputation sometimes.
No, I know, fairy tales have kind of given us a bad rep, but witches are natural healers. So that's basically what I do. And I like to introduce people to wild plants and to get a bit of an understanding that there's so much that you can actually do from an emotional perspective from healing and also from a physical perspective.
Okay, well, you brought some with us. So now when you're saying about foraging, so where can we go? So is it into the woods, into a meadow, into so anywhere really that has just plants growing?
Everywhere. Now, I will bring people on what I call an urban foraging ditch witchery walk, and that's along the Dodder here. You can do it like in your local estate. It just depends on what you're looking for and what you're going to use it for.
You've got to be careful, obviously, in what you pick up.
100%.
So, are you going to show us safe things?
I think we're going to go this one first. Sorry.
You want to go with this one here. So, this plant here is called chickweed. Chickweed. We have him just balanced down because he's really, really light. This plant will grow at lightning speed in your garden. Okay. So, and it'll grow like a carpet. It's really, really delicate. Little leaves, and they've got tiny little flowers on them that will start to go up a little bit more now as spring comes.
And where would you see? Where would you find these?
You will generally find these at the base of trees, at the base of lampposts, along ledges.
Lampposts?
Yes.
On the street, like?
On the street. And generally, it'll only grow where there's cracks in the earth.
Okay.
So that's nature trying to tell you how it's going to help you. So this is a fantastic plant for people.
Growing out of the cracks.
Well, it's fantastic for people who have eczema and psoriasis.
Okay.
So how do you eat it? Are you meant to eat it? Are you meant to turn it into a cream?
You can absolutely eat it. Stick that in your gob there.
And what, why, like though? What would this be good for?
Well, it's full of nourishment. It's packed with vitamin A, B, and C. And go on, go for it. You've got this. Not unpleasant.
Oh, it's pretty bland,
like
isn't
eating
it?
Grass.
It tastes like eating grass.
It tastes like eating grass. Not that I'm used to eating grass, but it just, if you're eating grass,
there's not much
like
flavour to it now,
Well,
Phoebe.
Listen, there's not necessarily supposed to be, but it...
Alan.
Go away. Will you like... go away?
Okay,
it doesn't have a taste.
So what's this called?
This is called chickweed. So, chickweed. As I said, this one is fantastic for people.
And what have you made that into a cream?
Yeah, I have one here called Skin Saver that I make. So I pull all the natural medicine out of this plant to make it.
How do you do that?
Mush it down.
A little bit of magic. You know, the witches have magic. No, I work with olive oil. So this is on a base of olive oil. So the olive oil will pull all the goodness out of it.
Right.
Want to have a try?
Can we try some?
Yeah,
oh, it's like Vaseline or something,
is it? Yeah, it's a
balm. Oh, it's a balm.
So you can apply it directly to your skin.
Okay.
Eczema, psoriasis.
Oh, it smells nice as
well. Yeah, contact dermatitis.
What other things have we got?
So I brought some other bits here. So this one here, most people will recognise. You'll see this growing all over the place. I'm not going to give you any to taste.
Yeah,
give Tommy
see him
some
in the kitchen. He's desperate.
This plant, can you taste these as well?
Yeah, you can. These are all edible. This plant is called plantain, and you will see it growing all over the place. Now, you'll recognise it a little later in the year. It grows big, long, single stems with little flowers that grow on the top of it.
Oh, right,
you'll recognise it that way. It's called...
But you don't eat the flower, you eat these.
These bits here. It has little ribs that run through it. See along there?
Right.
This plant was actually used by Alexander the Great.
Thanks, Al.
That's your lunch.
Right.
This was used by Alexander the Great on the battlefield. So if his warriors got a sword wound, they would have folded it up and stuck it into the sword wound, and that would have helped it to heal and stop infection forming.
This
would
really
plant, yeah.
So I don't eat it then.
You can stick it in your mouth.
It'll heal it.
The leaves on this one are a bit rougher, so I would tend to put this into soups and stews as opposed to into salads. But go on, listen, you're brave. It's just a leaf.
I can see what that make me do.
It'll,
is that going to make
turn
superhero?
You into, it'll turn
no,
you, right.
you'll actually come out with some audible sentences. Now.
Actually, can read the auto cue now. Okay, so what sort of creams would that have made
well,
for you?
Well, this one here, I would actually say to people, this is a walker or a hiker's best friend. If you're out and about up the mountains and your boot starts to rub or you get a cut, you can literally wrap this around the wound and it'll stop a plaster.
Okay.
Or stop a, it'll
and
like a
have
plaster.
You done that? Have you done this into one of your
None
creams?
None of these have this one in it,
right.
But that's what that one would do. So that's just one for if you're out and about. Okay. That's one to use, like a natural plaster.
And what's it
like
called? That? The
plantain.
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 Okay.
Plantain.
So if you cut yourself, stick a bit of plantain on it.
Plantain. A plantain plaster.
Okay, and the final one.
And this one here is yarrow. This is my favourite of all.
I've heard of yarrow.
Yeah, so yarrow, Oscailga, it's called Ahr Hallun, the father of all herbs.
Oh, wow.
And this one here is a super healer. It is what we call an analgesic. So it's like a painkiller, natural painkiller. So if you have a toothache, you can chew it and it'll start to numb out the area.
Now, yarrow goes back for centuries, and people know, like, put yarrow into things.
Absolutely,
yeah.
Absolutely. And its Latin name is Achillea millefolium, and that's after the warrior Achilles.
Oh, no way.
Because he would have used this on the battlefield to help his warriors.
Can you eat that as well? You can chew that.
If you want to try that one, it has a bit of a bitter taste. Go on for the crack. You're in it
I'm
now.
I'm going to taste this again.
Yeah, you're in it
Go on,
it
you
now.
Try this one as well. Go on, have some yarrow.
Like, it's healing now.
It's healing. You'll feel a bit of a tingle on your tongue.
There's a flavour in that
one. Yeah, there is, isn't there? So,
but why would you eat it if you didn't have a toothache?
Well, if you didn't have a toothache, don't eat it.
You don't have to.
Okay.
You don't have
but
to.
Could you put it in soups or
you
water
can.
Or
you can,
something
you can
like
put
that?
It, you can make a tea from it.
A
you
tea
can,
from it?
Yeah, you can chop it into salads if you want to, but it is. It's quite it's quite a floral taste.
And what's your range called? Forever?
Forager.
Oh, Forager.
Forager Forever.
Read.
There's a
forager
whole new brand.
Have you anything for eyesight? if you have any, if people are interested in this, have you any kind of like five or a couple of tips for people?
So if you are hoping to get out and start foraging yourself, I would say the first thing first is know where you are foraging. Don't go wandering into someone's private property.
No, exactly.
That's always a good one to do. But also, aside from that, be sure that you're not foraging where there is lots of passing traffic, where there's going to be pollution and the plants that you're going to be using are going to be full of, you know, fumes. Another one would be to always kind of keep above hip height where possible. We share our environment with wildlife and animals. They use these plants, like they're natural foragers. This is how they eat. They can't pop into the local shops. And also, creatures pee down low as well.
Yeah,
so height, yeah.
Touch, where possible. I would always tell people to bring along some tools with them so that you don't either sting your hands or that you're not, if you're taking some berries or plants, that you're not pulling on a bush and damaging it, whereas you can just snip the bits that you
want. And of course, like, they are natural herbal medicines, but of course, if you do have a problem, make sure to consult with your GP.
100%, 100%. And I would always say that these are just a lovely way to complement.
Well, congratulations on your
skin range, your forager skin range.
Thank you so much.
No, this is like deep heat.
Yes, that's deep heat.
Oh, wow.
That's made
better than you now.
That's
Phoebe,
made of wintergreen.
Foran, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you so much.
Very interesting, yeah. Now, coming up next, The Whale, Pamela Anderson's new documentary, and Puss in Boots are all on the agenda for our viewer, Brian Lloyd. We'll see you in a few minutes.
Welcome back. We've got the best things to watch this weekend.
Brian Lloyd is here to give us all the details. Good morning to you, Brian.
Good morning.
So we're going to start with The Whale.
Yeah. So this is Brendan Fraser. This is the film that's been getting all the talk for his Oscar nominations, for all the other nominations, Golden Globes. This is based on the stage play, and what's going on in this is Brendan Fraser plays this English professor who has ballooned and weighed to 600 pounds as a shut-in, and it follows the course of basically his final days, him trying to come to terms with, you know, his failed marriage, his estranged daughter, played by Sadie Sink, who people will know from Stranger Things, and also as well the fact that he is, you know, gotten to this stage in his life. There's been a huge backlash to this film over the fact that Brendan Fraser is, you know, wearing a fat suit in it. And also, like, a lot of people are claiming that the film is fat-phobic. Mm. I agree with that, to be honest. I mean, I do agree with that, I have to say, because I saw this film and, like, the way that it's done in it is that, you know, when you see him eating, like, they really kind of, like, turn up the sound and they make it all that kind of wet kind of noise of him chewing, and the music is almost turns into a horror film. So, like, the film is supposed to be about, you know, the shame that he feels and the grief that he feels for losing his partner and for his life kind of being a mess. But then it makes you be disgusted by him. It wants you to kind of look at him in a sort of, like, you're supposed to be reviled by him.
Oh.
Which is very, very confusing, you know, that sort of way. Like, you're supposed to feel empathy for him, but then at the same time, it wants you to be disgusted by him.
So, like, you're nearly going, oh, it's your own fault, and you're like,
that's
look
kind
at
of
you,
it.
And you're like,
Yeah. And, like, you know, like, the director of this, Darren Aronofsky, like, he's known for making films that are really, really extreme, like Requiem for a Dream. Yeah, and that film messed people up, and rightfully so. But even further to that, like, you know, you have The Wrestler, that one with Mickey Rourke, like, and that's really about people who put their bodies on the line and all the rest of it. Brendan Fraser.
The Fountain.
Underrated.
Weird
film.
Yes.
But Brendan Fraser is brilliant in it.
That's why he's nominated for the Oscar.
Yeah, and if it was just him and it was another director and it didn't have all those problems, I'd be saying this is brilliant and you should go out and watch it. But I would say that this is a brilliant performance inside something really, really terrible.
Okay. All
right. Yeah. That's really,
it's really that,
interesting.
It's really that bad. Like, I mean, it really put me off the film. Like, I thought Brendan Fraser was brilliant in it. I thought everyone else was brilliant in it. But the way that it handled his character and the way that it made you to be disgusted by him was so confusing, like, and so bad, like, you know,
okay,
that kind of way, like,
that's really interesting. So great performances, cast great, bad movie,
bad. 2 out of 5.
Two,
yeah, and like the two, and the two are all Brendan Fraser and the cast.
And we know that Hollywood loves a comeback story, so let's take a look at Brendan Fraser in the Whale and see if he's going to win an award.
You're an amazing person, Ellie. I couldn't ask for a more incredible daughter.
Are you actually trying to parent me right now?
Who would want me to be a part of their life?
You don't stay in touch with Mom?
She really only tells me things about you.
Why?
Because that's all I want to know about.
Why'd you gain all that weight?
Someone close to me passed away, and it had an effect on me.
You haven't seen her since she was 8 years old, and you're gonna reconnect with her?
Sorry.
I don't like this. This isn't a good idea.
I'm sorry.
But then, is it?
Like, yeah,
the makeup,
I mean, like,
is very good that he looks like that.
Yeah, it does. Like, he was in a fat suit, and, like, he does have all the makeup. Yeah, I mean, it is. Like, but again, it's that thing of, it shows him doing all that kind of stuff. Like, it's done in such a way that you are to be you are meant to be disgusted by him, which is just really problematic, I think.
So he hasn't seen his daughter Sadie sing for 8 years.
Yeah, for 8 years. Right. Yeah, okay, yeah. That's interesting. And he's gay, and this is the whole thing. He's gay, but he had a brief marriage to Samantha Morton's character.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Is he going to win the Oscar for it?
Yeah, because I'd say so.
Do you over Colin Farrell and the rest?
Yeah, I'd be pretty sure. Because you were talking about it. It's a comeback story.
Like. It's a comeback story of Brendan Fraser, who has tried to talk about the abuse he suffered in Hollywood. The sexual abuse that he suffered in Hollywood, and he was shut down and he was shut out of the industry for so long.
Yeah.
Really?
So he
alleges that he was sexually assaulted by the president of the Hollywood Foreign Press Association, which is over the Golden Globes. And it happened like 2003. He did an interview with Marc Maron a couple of weeks ago, and he talked about it. And like, it's still clearly very, very fresh for him. Like, it was 20 years ago, and he still remembers it vividly. Like.
Wow. Which I think for any survivor of abuse it's always there in your brain. So we will see what happens with that. But again, you've just given it 2 stars. We're going to move on to something completely
totally different.
I don't think we need him to tell us, break it down, what it's about. Let's just take a clip.
It's Puss in Boots.
I'm supposed to be a fearless hero, a legend.
This is a person party. That's your party.
So this is where dignity goes to die.
The years start coming and they don't stop coming.
You're Puss in Boots?
Let's talk.
No hablo inglés.
¿Hablas español? Yo también. Ah, ¿de dónde eres? ¿Te gustan las siestas?
I don't speak Spanish either.
You're funny. What's your story?
My story.
What are we looking at?
Cats have 9 lives. Watch! Watch! Watch!
Boss, I think you set the oven too high!
Now I am on my last life.
Oh no!
I want to go see it.
I love so the first good. One.
Yeah.
But I love all the Shrek ones that he was Same. In, the character in. But I love the first one.
I don't know. Like, what I always loved about all the Shrek films is that, like, they're smart without being smug.
Yes.
As in, like, the jokes in it are so funny and so kind of clever and witty. Like, and even getting Antonio Banderas to play essentially just like Zorro, but as a cat, is just so clever. So, but there's a great, there's a brilliant cast in this. Olivia Colman and Ray Winstone, play Papa Bear and Mama Bear. Florence Pugh plays Goldilocks. You have Salma Hayek Pinault playing Kitty Softpaws. You have John Mulaney playing the villain in it as well. And then you have it's such a good cast. But I mean, it's so funny. It is. I was howling watching this.
Is it better than the first one?
I'd nearly say it actually is now that I think about it. Yeah, all the spin-offs, definitely. It's better than the first one, for sure. Like, it's so damn funny.
Yeah,
like.
And it's aimed at the kids, but the adults get everything
100%.
As well.
No, definitely. And in fact, I would nearly say that you could, like, go to see this, like, on a Friday evening at 7 o'clock, have a couple of drinks, and you'll be, like, it's so good. So, so good.
And it's got a different style to the... It's got a fresher look?
Yeah, it's kind of been inspired by Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, in that it looks very kind of, like, painterly or whatever.
Yeah.
So it looks gorgeous. Like, it's beautiful to see it on the big screen, but it's hilarious.
Oh, dying to see that now.
How many stars?
4 out of 5.
Four. Yeah. Very good. I was literally going to watch this last night and I went, oh, it's a bit too long. It's good to say where your attention span just goes. Pamela.
Yeah, so this is Pamela, a love story. This is the new documentary that's on Netflix. Talks about basically everything about Pamela Anderson, about how she was discovered, you know, in a football game and then was on a jumbotron. And it's really kind of like, it starts off as the fairy tale, really. Like, you know, the fact that she was just a regular young woman in Canada, got discovered, went to the Playboy Mansion, became this Playboy star. Then just in the space of like nearly a couple of weeks, she went from that to Baywatch. And, you know, it's interesting because like to hear her tell it, it's like a fairy tale. And then it just drops off a clip
Everything
when the sex tape comes
changes.
In.
Let's have a little look at Pamela.
I didn't sleep last night at all. If anybody's watching this, go to hell. I blocked that stolen tape out of my life in order to survive. And now that it's all coming up again, I feel sick. I want to take control of the narrative for the first time.
I don't think people consider her the owner of her own image. It's Pamela Anderson, public property.
I didn't feel like I had a lot of respect.
Did you want to be a serious actress?
I am a serious actress. I had to make a career out of the pieces left
but I'm not the damsel in distress. I put myself in crazy situations. And survived them.
Oh, maybe I should have watched it last.
No, it's definitely worth the watch. I mean, it's a fascinating documentary in the sense of, as you said it there, you know, she was trying to be a serious actress. She did all the work. I mean, when Barbed Wire came out, like, it was, people were kind of comparing it to, you know, Jane Fonda and Barbarella, the idea of, like, there's a bit of a kind of a silly kind of sci-fi film, but will eventually go on and have a good career. And she was, like, very, like, emotionally mature about her, you know, the way that she was perceived, but wanted to kind of take ownership of it. But, I mean, the documentary is a direct reaction to Pam and Tommy, that TV series was on Disney+. Mm. But it's interesting, like, you go and watch Pam and Tommy, like, they're very... They don't judge her in any kind of way. Like, I mean, if you watch Pam and Tommy, like, they are very forthright about the fact that it was a complete violation, that, you know, this was a tape that was not intended for public display at all. Mm. And also that as well is that it completely tanked her career. Mm. So when she talks about it in the documentary, she's more or less kind of repeating the same things that Pam and Tommy have covered, but it's just, it's her words telling, you know, that kind of, and she has ownership of
it. How many stars?
Like three and a half out of five, yeah. It's worth a watch. It's definitely worth a watch.
Speaking of stars, we're talking about Ian McKellen. He's coming to Dublin, not to make a movie, not to make a TV series, not to do Shakespeare.
No, to do Mother Goose, which
is a panto.
He's coming
to do Panto.
Yeah, which is brilliant. Like, him and John Bishop.
Is he in your panto?
No, he's not in my panto. He's in his own panto. I actually went to see it in London at the weekend, and it's absolutely...
Is it,
Oh, my God. You just can't take your eyes off Ian McKellen. Like,
he's so good, isn't he?
At 82 years of age... To be still doing what he's doing.
What's Mother himself. Goose? What's it about?
Well, it's Mother Goose. The goose who lays the golden egg.
Thank you.
Oh, there you go. It just jumped up in there.
He plays Mother Goose.
Okay, he lays a golden egg.
He doesn't
lay
the
golden
egg.
He plays Mrs. Goose. Yeah. And then there's a goose. But, like, seriously, to have Ian McKellen and John Bishop on stage, and he was doing all his Lord of the Rings.
Where is it?
And he was doing a soliloquy, and he's doing all this. It's brilliant.
It's happening in the Borgosh.
Yeah, it's coming to the Borgosh from the 22nd till the 26th of March. Go and see it. It's hilarious.
That?
I loved it.
Is that a horse?
What's that I hear? Oh, my God.
Our little donkey.
Our little donkey.
Donkey.
Coming
you
up
could
on,
be in Puss in Boots.
Coming up on tomorrow's Art of Day, I'm president of the European Parliament.
Oh, my God.
We'll be
in
studio for jazz.
There we go. And we're getting some tips to help those green-fingered children who want to start gardening. See you tomorrow.